everything in our technological realm, everything in your house, everything in this building, every medicine you've ever had the benefit of, comes from two words. Things that have been discovered and things that have been engineered with the benefit of human brains. Many of those discoveries come from the fruits of Mother Nature. Some of them come from tinkering. And we've had a pretty extraordinary degree to learn principles about the world around us and create new things. However, particularly in life science, another word is going to drive a lot of the future of technology. That word is generate. Because particularly in life sciences, we aren't very good at understanding the way that the living world works. And with help from machine intelligence to master patterns that we don't have access to, some of the most extraordinary life science innovations are going to arise. Now, the reason this is going to be valuable is pretty simple. There isn't a life scientist on the planet that can glance at this slide and tell you whether any of these paragraphs of DNA would cure you, kill you, or win you a Nobel Prize. And so we've had a really limited ability to actually read the code of life. We've been sequencing it and seeing it, but reading it, meaning comprehending the functions that it contains, has been really, really difficult. And so if you can't read the code of life, you can understand why it might constrain your ability to discover and your ability to engineer. Now, I'll take you back to a first biology class really quickly. So what paragraphs of DNA can do in life is sometimes they produce a messenger molecule called an mRNA. mRNAs instruct the synthesis of a protein one amino acid at a time that forms a long string like a necklace that then folds itself into a structure that performs a function in biology. Now, you all know that in our daily life, protein sounds like bacon, or post-workout energy drink, or eggs. Zooming in, proteins are the most extraordinary molecular engines, machines, devices, and sensors in our whole technological realm. They are often the smallest, and even cooler, they all start life as a noodle and fold themselves into those technologies. I mean, this is the equivalent of if your car, your refrigerator, your house arrived as a noodle and folded itself into the form that you enjoy.
Jetson's car.
So, in your first biology class, you might find it to be profound that the left and right sides of this slide are connected. The more biology classes you've taken thereafter, the easier it is to lose track of that. In that what that means is that all of the properties of hundreds of billions of dollars of protein therapeutics today have their functions implicitly encoded in the DNA sequences from which they arise. And humanity has had virtually no ability to read those and see a piece of DNA and describe quantitatively what an antibody might be binding to, with what affinity and binding pose and other properties. And therefore, we've had even more limited ability to write, meaning to be able to say, what would the DNA sequence need to be in order to create a protein with the following functions? So, as everybody here knows, we've now entered the era of generative AI creating the world around us. Most of that is taking place in the realm of text and language or visuals. This is from a great New York Times article 3 years ago. And none of these people have ever existed. Statistically, they won't ever exist. And the machine learning models that have generated them have learned nothing explicit about the physics of human eyeglasses or hair or facial hair or facial tissue. But they have mastered the patterns of what it means to be a human face so as to generate uncountable numbers of new examples that are indiscernible to the human eye from reality. Now, 6 years ago, I'm proud to be a co-founder of a company where much less visually compelling versions of these were underway at the version of pixelated images of people or pixelated images of cats and dogs and aspects of the world around us. And we started to imagine that maybe that isn't just going to be true for two-dimensional pictures of biology. And maybe it won't just be true for macroscopic perspectives of biology. And maybe at any length scale, AI is going to be able to generate biology with a level of mastery that we have never had. And particularly, we got interested in proteins, the machines of life, both because they're so beautiful and also because they had the advantage of two rarities in biology, two very large and high-quality data sets that might allow us to learn some of those functions. One of those is all DNA sequence. We grabbed every genome that has been sequenced and put in the public domain with the perspective that machines might gain a Shakespearean mastery of what it means to write DNA for a protein with a given function. The second was all three-dimensional crystal structures of proteins that have been created thus far and protein-protein interactions. And we imagined that maybe from those three-dimensional examples of proteins in solitary confinement or with one neighbor, we might be able to learn some of the rules by which amino acids like to interact with each other from the way that they do interact with each other in those proteins examples. And if we could learn that, we might be able to gain the ability to generate a sequence of amino acids that might want to interact with the outside of a protein. And that sounds really simple. If you could do that, that might unseat the way we create all antibodies, all peptides, all growth factors and cytokines. Virtually every therapeutic and biotechnology that is a protein today carries out that one function, trying to stick to a specific target while not sticking to other things. So what if you could ask, what is the DNA sequence of a protein that would hit this target at exactly this location? So 6 years ago, that seemed like a crazy idea. But one that was worthwhile trying, given that other approaches hadn't made a lot of progress against that goal. Publicly available data allowed us to kind of do the version of crawling. I have a zero-year-old at home, and crawling should not be underestimated. It is a laudable feat. You have to figure a lot out to do that. But that meant sometimes, rarely, our models would generate a sequence that was able to bind to a specific location on a target. To improve them, we had to build the equivalent of an embodiment of that AI's ability to access the real world, which means a lab in which we can run experiments on every sequence that is flowing from the models so as to quantitatively test whether or not the predictions are true. We've now run millions of examples of proteins around this wheel, and now the models are starting to do some things that to us are extraordinary. So here's an example from a couple of years ago. We challenged the team to take the top $50 billion of antibody therapeutic sales and generate new antibodies that would hit the same target at the same epitope, which means the spot on that target, with the same structural conformation at the interface and the same binding pose with comparable or better affinity without going anywhere near the intellectual property of that parent molecule. Within 3 months, the team was able to do this for 100% of them. And by comparison, if you had conventional tools and a way bigger organization, you wouldn't be able to do that in about 10 years. You'd find things that stick elsewhere or somewhere. But the criteria I just described is kind of like Robin Hood splitting the first arrow by firing an arrow right down the center of it 50 times in a row. And the reason that has the potential to be valuable is every time an antibody shows on a target that it can provide a benefit to patients, humanity has the ability to potentially now access the very best antibody. So sometimes that first one is the best, but most of the time it has limitations that prevent it from being the medicine that is possible. And yet, that's mostly a product of how limited our search approaches have been thus far. This appears to vastly expand the efficiency of search for those kinds of solutions. So that's an example of being able to create antibodies against targets that we can already hit, but to make them better. We also ask questions as to whether we might be able to hit things that it isn't evident that other systems have been capable of doing that. So this is everybody's favorite acronym, COVID. That little cuddly thing sticking out of it is the spike protein everybody has grown to love. And the portion of the spike protein that binds to ACE2 so as to dock on certain cells in our body has been changing voraciously. so that the antibodies you got from your last infection may not be so beneficial in your current or your next infection. But there are other portions of the spike protein that haven't changed almost at all from the first variant to the wildest variants today, and even are conserved when you walk up the tree of life of SARS viruses. Unfortunately, nobody's immune system in this room is very good at creating antibodies against those portions. Otherwise, we might get to marginalize this acronym for good reason. We asked whether generative AI might give us some additional help in finding antibodies that could. So this is how that portion works that's conserved. The spike protein unfolds in that region to do the most important thing for a virus to be able to infect you, which is fusing its membrane with yours and throwing its genetic contents into the interior of your cells. What we found is if by being able to generate antibodies that hit that portion, we can prevent that most important event, neutralizing the virus from being able to enter into our cells. So maybe generative AI isn't just going to create beautiful cartoons and limericks to entertain ourselves and one another and access knowledge that is already resident within humanity. It may just expand our access to new knowledge and new technologies in important ways. This may be important for the next pandemic. It may be important for bringing technologies like antibodies to targets that they haven't been able to reach in medicine yet. So I just gave you two examples of using generative AI models for protein design for antibodies. Same models allow us to engineer and create new enzymes. In fact, we've been able to create enzymes where we've thrown 100 or 200 mutations into an enzyme simultaneously. When you do that, you have 19 other options for amino acids at every one of those locations. That is 19 to the 100 or 200 power. The probability of one of those working would be flat zero. When you put two mutations into an average protein, it usually stops working. Throwing in 100 or 200 gives you no chance. But some of these situations, with a coin flip, these models are able to predict a protein with that much change that still functions, vastly changing our ability to be able to hop to points of function in otherwise largely empty biological search space. The same models are applicable to peptide design, such that as we get wiser with antibody design, it helps us become wiser in peptide design. They're applicable to cell surface molecules and to scaffolds of multiple proteins. So I want to leave you with an idea. Usually when a new technology comes along, it is tempting to imagine, particularly in a place like biology where Mother Nature's had her lab open for about 3 billion years, that maybe it's just going to improve things a tiny bit. I don't think that's the right mental model here. It might be that the slow portion of biology is now behind us, and there's a much faster biology ahead of us. In that even with generous assumptions around everything Mother Nature has ever had the chance to build and test throughout the entire history of evolution, all of her lab has tested less than the expanse of one drop of water relative to all of the Earth's oceans of possible protein sequences. So think about that for just a second. Everybody in this room, every protein that makes our lives possible, every one of our ancestors and everything else in the living world that has ever been, fits into that one drop of water. I'm a huge fan of the age of great exploration when lighter, stronger ships allowed people to start bravely circumnavigating the globe. I've been envious of that until late, in that it seems like we're going to get to sail on the oceans of unexplored biology over the next decade and more. And if everything we know is in that one drop of water, if we find one more drop of water, that'll be a really big deal. But there really isn't a reason to believe that it's going to be limited to that. So just imagine what could be. Biology is majestic as it already is. And all of Mother Nature's brilliance has only been able to touch that one tiny portion. So if this is what we believe, we will have some sensational and very important medicines ahead of us, and this is going to be a beautiful adventure. Thank you for your time.